As you know, we did a study in the 1980s and 1990s of this topic in two high security English prisons. And one of them was a very restricted regime. For example, the prisoners were only allowed out of their cells to the evening leisure time on two evenings in every three in order to reduce the number of people on the landings so as to so that the staff could keep order more easily. So it was very restricted, and of course the prisoners did not like that. And the other prison was a very liberal regime. It was self-consciously liberal. It said we like to keep a very liberal regime, and the reason for that is we want to create conditions that are as close as possible to those of the outside community, so that the prisoners can live an ordinary life as far as possible, and essentially we trust them to behave well. What we found was that in general the prisoners preferred the second prison to the first prison, but there were complications. For example, in the second prison, although the most prisoners responded well to the freedom, a small number of prisoners were rather weak prisoners, and they were and it was given the freedom, it was very easy for them to be attacked, and they felt unprotected and insecure, and that was very bad. On the other hand, clearly it's better if you can not put prisoners behind in their cells one evening in three. So we concluded that there is no easy answer to the question what kind of regime is better. Different kinds of regimes have advantages and disadvantages, and the key question for prison governors is really how to create a sufficient degree of restriction that will keep all prisoners safe, while at the same time also allowing a degree of freedom to allow them to develop personalities, new interests, and so on, with a view to moving on towards release. So it's a difficult balance, and it's important not to be either too restrictive or too liberal. My colleague and I did a study of desistance in Sheffield in England, and you can do studies of desistance with different kinds of offenders, male or female, older or younger, more or less criminal. We chose to do our work with a sample of young men aged on average 20 who had a high degree of previous criminality, and many of them went on to reoffend a number of times. But the really interesting thing about the study was that most of them actually didn't want to remain as offenders. They wanted to change their lives. They wanted to live a normal life in the long-term future. So most of them took steps towards desistance, but they had many disadvantages because they had mostly had troubled backgrounds. So they often had difficult family backgrounds. Most of them had left school with no qualifications, and because the economy has changed, there are relatively few unskilled jobs left, and so many of them had very poor work records. And so by the time they wanted to change, aged about 20, they were facing a situation where the obstacles to change were really quite high, because they had quite a significant criminal record, they had no qualifications, and a very poor work record. And you can imagine that in those circumstances it is really quite difficult to turn your life around. The things that did make a difference were essentially relationships. So for most of them, it was important to leave behind the relationships with their former criminal friends. But also it was important often to build a new relationship, perhaps with a girlfriend. And we also found that whereas their relationships with their parents, especially their mothers, had become strained as a result of the of their offending, when they started to desist, those relationships quite often improved. And then the mother was really quite an important agent of the relationship with the mother was an important matter in helping the offender to turn his life around. They were, I should have said, they were all males. Yes, family relationships and other social background relationships are, without any question, very important. First of all, in relation to why people offend in the first place, but then you specifically asked about desistance. And then if somebody, having become quite a persistent offender, as our offenders were, wanting to desist, then there are a lot of social handicaps to overcome, the process of relationships with other people can be very important. And really, the state authorities need to learn to build on those positive relationships and to assist them as far as possible in order to help the process of desistance. The answer to that is not necessarily, because the politicians don't always want to know. So for example, in the late 1990s, when I was the director of the Cambridge Institute of Criminology, we were asked to carry out a study of all the available literature on whether longer sentences deter other people from offending. So, for example, if you know that if you commit a certain kind of offence, you will get 10 years instead of 7, will that deter you from committing a crime? We carried out an extensive search of the literature, and we came up with the conclusion that in general, the answer to that question is no, it doesn't make much difference, because it's not the length of the sentence that matters so much as whether you are going to be caught. If you're thinking of committing an offence, your primary question is, am I going to be caught or not? And you don't think so much about whether it's 7 or 10 years. So we gave this report to the British Home Office, and they said, thank you very much, but we don't agree with your conclusions. So not necessary. And they put in place a policy that was based on the principle of deterrent, that longer sentences would be a deterrent. So sometimes we have no effect. But on the other hand, there can be effects. For example, a colleague and I have done a number of studies in the recent past on the topic of legitimacy and what makes a criminal justice agent, a police officer or a prison officer or a probation officer, what makes that person a legitimate authority in the eyes of offenders in particular. It's a very complicated topic, and there have been various studies as to what creates greater legitimacy by the police when they're acting, for example. We have my colleague and I have come up with a particular set of ideas that, based on the research, that there are, in principle, particularly four matters which are particularly likely to help police officers in particular to become legitimate in the eyes of those they are dealing with. And these four things are distributive justice, that's they treat everyone the same, so they don't discriminate on the basis of race, for example. And procedural justice, which means treating people with respect and allowing them to explain their side of the story. And then they have to also act lawfully. And they need to be efficient, because if they're not, you know, if people feel they're not being efficient in reducing crime in their neighborhood and so on, then they will lose legitimacy. So these four things, distributive justice, procedural justice, lawfulness, and effectiveness, come through from the research as being very important. And in England, we are distributing that to police services, and they are increasingly acting on, you know, yes, we need to do these four things. And how that is then translated into practice is more a matter for police chiefs than for the academics, but the principle has been accepted. And very recently, that fourfold characterization has also been accepted by a prestigious committee in the United States. So that is within the last month or so. So we hope that this message will also become more widely known in the US and maybe even elsewhere.